Do you know, I've got to tell you something. When I first heard that record, I thought it was going to write a classic, which is quite a different thing, isn't it?
But that's right.
Got to write a classic. Do you think you did?
I hope I did. I think I wrote a classic, yeah. I think most people have been saying beautiful things about the record.
Did you write it in an attic?
I did write it in an attic, yeah.
What attic?
My mother's attic.
Tell me about that.
No, I was staying at home with my mother for a while. And she had this attic room. And I used to go up there at night and sleep. And I was going through some bad times at the time. And one night I sort of laid on the bed and just sat there and fondled with some paper. And I wanted to get out of the bad times, like we all do when we get bad times. And I thought, I got to write a hit.
Got to.
I got to write a hit, because I just wanted to keep on with music. I love music. Music's my life. And instead of saying I got to write a hit, I said I got to write a classic. And I was in the attic, and there you go.
It was a downtime, though. You didn't really know that you were going to get a classic or a hit out of it.
No, not at all. Yeah. I mean, it was just a song like every other song I've ever written as a writer.
I reckon that you must have started your musical career because, I mean, you laugh when I say you've been around for quite some time, but you must have started when you were about 13 or 15 because you played with so many of the big groups, haven't you, in the last 15 years?
I did. I started when I was 14 and a half. 15, I was professional out on the road. Yeah. Playing rock guitar, and then I went into my first hit record, Race for the Devil, The Gun, then Buddy Miles, America, then Ginger Baker, Baker Gurvitz Army, then I wrote albums for the solo Moody Blues, Graham Edge.
And yet it seems to me that you were not a star, not a star name, do you know what I mean? Do you think now you're becoming a star?
I don't know.
You want to be one, don't you?
Well, I don't know whether I want to be a star, as such as a star. I just want to be known as a great writer, a great songwriter. And I love the industry, and if it means being called a star, then I suppose that's what you got to label me, but I never thought about it really that way.
It's nice to hear somebody saying, I love the industry, meaning they love the whole idea of music, because so many people knock it and say it's destructive. You mentioned Hendrix, and there does seem to be a high incidence of self-destruction in the rock business, doesn't there?
Yeah, unfortunately, people take success and stardom the wrong way. They get too carried away with themselves, and they think they're God knows what, and they get into trouble. They delve into certain areas that they shouldn't delve into, and before they know what's happened, it's goodbye world and hello new one.
Yeah, but you can't blame the music business for that. It's something within the person themselves, isn't
it? I don't think you can blame the industry for it at all. It is the person himself, whether or not he wants to get into that trip.
You've never been tempted?
I've dabbled in a couple of things, but I've never been interested. I'm a freak for eating, and I'm a freak for squash, and staying fit and looking well. If I get a spot on my face, I'll get panicked. I've always wanted to look after myself. I like myself and I like the world I live in.
Are you kind of a pious person then?
Can you explain that word to me? I mean,
well, somebody who almost smug about the way they control their lives.
Smug? Yeah, I am. Very smug about the way I control my life and the way that I live. Yeah.
Where does that strength then come from? Your own self-control and your own discipline?
Well, it comes from a certain area that we can grasp it from. And I just know how to grasp it.
What does that mean? You asked me about pious, so I'll ask you about a certain area.
Well, I think there's areas around us that we can tune into. And in your life. And when I was a young boy, I always used to feel these areas around me. I used to feel that I was special, always. that life was important, that where I was going was important in life. And it was, everything else was just secondary around me to that one thing. I always felt it wherever I went. And it's just been with me since I was a young child.
When you say young, how old? About seven or something?
No, I became aware of it about nine, eight or nine. Used to wander around, always thinking this thing inside of me, and it's just always kept me strong. I used to have this thing, if I was on an aeroplane or a train or a car traveling somewhere, so look out the window, I think, here I am in another direction. But there's only one direction. There's only one true direction to go in, and that's the correct direction. There's only one road that's the right road. There's many roads, but you've got to pick the right one.
Did you tell other people about this? I mean, did you tell your mother, your father, that you had found a certain path that you knew was correct?
Well, I didn't tell my father because we haven't been that close. And it's something you can't really tell people. I mean, I've tried to tell various people, sometimes in conversations, but they say, oh, Adrian's off again, you know, he's going a bit potty.
Yeah, I suppose it's trying to explain colour to somebody who's blind. Did you feel that?
Well, that's a strong way of putting it, but you could say that.
Tell me about your childhood. Where were you born? How were you brought up?
I was born in London, Hospital somewhere, one of those little hospitals. I was then moved out to Leighton, where I grew up to about four or five. I was then taken out to Chapel Heath by my parents, who split up and divorced when I was eight. And then I grew up from there in Ilford. Basically, Ilford was my roots, that's where I grew up.
And when did music start? In Ilford?
Music started in Chapel Heath when I was 8 years old.
With what? A guitar, wasn't it?
There was a guitar around the house, and I used to plonk it and sit by the radio and copy songs on one string, and then I got to two strings, and then three strings, and then four, five, and six, and so on, and just gradually progressed on my own.
You're completely self-taught. I mean, the way you play the piano, you taught yourself that too?
Piano and guitar, yeah.
Because do you think you would have been a different, I didn't say better, a different musician if you had, for instance, gone to the Royal Academy?
I'd have been a better musician.
Do you really reckon so?
I think so. I think technically I'd have been better. But I don't know if my feel would have been better. I mean, there's a certain feel that you can capture that has nothing to do with technique, that is unexplainable.
Passion.
Passion, feel, movement. Yeah. That's something you acquire over the years, because many times you get fingerprints on your brain, you know, over those years.
Fingerprints on
your brain. It's an expression that I use. It means you get well touched over the years in your brain, and the things that touch you and the things that you pick up over those years come out in your feel.
Aside from that inner feeling, aside from your devotion to music, what else is important in your life?
Family is very important.
I know your mother is.
Oh, she's very important, yeah. And my brother, and my grandmother, and friends. I'm a very family-oriented person. I like it close, very close.
How do they feel about this, comparatively speaking, sudden success?
They're delighted. They're delighted. They're
now,
thrilled.
How much in this world depends upon talent, gifts? How much depends upon luck, do you think?
A lot of luck.
Luck.
A lot of luck. But I think it's down to you personally, as a person, where you are going to get. How you treat other people, how you talk to other people. Every person is important. Everyone. And if you always remember that, and try and act like a decent human being, I don't think anyone will, you know, nobody will get in your way. But when I was young, I used to be very brash and loud-mouthed, and, well, 18 and very successful. And you make enemies and they stop you. any way they can. But I think I've learnt my lesson. You just be yourself, be at peace with the world, and you'll get on. If you've got a little bit of talent.
Or quite a lot of talent. Because I was thinking of, you were talking about the knowledge that you had when you were 8, that there was something very special, a path ahead of you, which is almost like destiny, fate. Is there a difference between being destined towards something or just having luck thrust upon you? That sounds awfully serious, but you know what I mean.
I know what you mean, but that's something that I would have to explain at length, okay. I think. Your destiny sometimes can be changed by your own movement. People think that things are mapped out for them, but in fact you can change your own destiny by wanting enough. I believe that if you want something that bad and you tune in and want it and pray for it and pray to your own God, your God, and you think about it, and other people around you, close to you, that love you, think about it, a bond is struck with them thinking about it for no gain and you thinking about it because you want it so much, and something just happens. I mean, look, cameras, lights, you, classic, a hit, right? It just happens.
Adrian Gurvitz, thank you very much for being our guest today. It's been fascinating. You're good.